Up on Harvest, she's a hardworking singer-songwriter with an impressive 9 albums to prove it. Dove Award-winning Cheri Keaggy joins us in Studio B, and he's a faithful supporter of shortwave radio. LeSEA Broadcasting partner Fred Felton shares why he believes that the mission of shortwave radio is a vital ministry. Middle East correspondent Brian Bush stands by in Jerusalem with an update on the latest news that's coming out of the Middle East. We want you to stay with us. The Harvest Show starts right now. Hello and welcome to The Harvest Show on a brand new Monday and a brand new week. Glad that you can be with us and trust your weekend went well. Seems like summer is still trying to hang on, but I think we're all looking forward to fall a little bit. I know my daughter is this weekend. She said, Dad, can't wait till cool weather comes and start to see the trees changing and the leaves start getting pretty.
I'm going to say speak for yourself. I need a little more summer. Hey, when I walked out this morning, I was like, wow, it's just a little nippy, but yeah. I can't wait to see the beautiful colors. And you can only get that in fall.
In the fall, that's right.
In the Midwest. Mm-hmm. Well, in other parts of the country, but certainly in other parts.
Did you see the snow that hit? I believe it was Calgary, Alberta, Canada, which... You know, it gets cold up there, the far north.
Yes, it does.
But for this early in the year, they had several inches of snow, and it was just absolutely freakish. There was a rainstorm. Something in the upper atmosphere changed with where the winds were coming from, and it got cold enough to freeze the rain and actually became snowflakes. To the order of several
inches.
Stop
it!
I know. I'm cold already.
Oh, I look good today. Look beautiful. Big news this weekend, and wasn't covered much in the mainstream national media. It was written in local papers, and I think in some national publications as well. But when it comes to televised media, not a whole lot of national coverage. But there were thousands of protesters outside of Planned Parenthood clinics around the country on Saturday. An organized event that took place about 320 or so Planned Parenthood centers across the 50 states. And really, some of the outcomes were quite spectacular. Much of this is in response to the expose that's been done showing how far off Planned Parenthood has gotten with respect to, you know, the devaluation of human life.
You know, Chuck, I don't know about you, but in all of my years of being a journalist, I have never seen a deliberate attempt like this to keep quiet a major story for political correctness sake or, you know, for whatever reason. But this is a huge event that took place, as you said, Stephen, around the country, and yet there's very little word about it. And then when you do hear it, and then the story's just not balanced.
That's right.
You know, talking about how Planned Parenthood is a needed, provides needed medical attention.
Services. Yes.
But we don't ever hear, no one wants to talk about these precious little babies who are being torn apart in the womb as a result of Planned Parenthood's efforts to sell body parts.
Right, and that's kind of the news expose, or the breaking expose was basically the sale of the body parts and just the callousness by which the business industry side kind of functions in this area.
And I hate to say this, but if it were animal, if we were selling puppy parts, boy, the networks would be all over it and there would be outrage from coast to coast. But because people have their own political agendas and many of those people seem to be involved in television news, you're not seeing that kind of outrage from coast to coast. God bless the people that came out and protested outside Planned Parenthood. I know locally there were probably about 400 to 500 protesters outside the Planned Parenthood, and the one here in northern Indiana that they were at is not one where abortions are performed. And to be clear, Governor Pence ordered an investigation of the Indiana Planned Parenthoods. And they said that the ones in Indiana are not involved in the sale of these body parts. But this expose continues to put out videos that make Planned Parenthood look more and more heinous in what they're doing. When you have a doctor show the beating heart of a child and they continue to talk about harvesting the brain of that child. And I forget what senator it was who was on one of the Sunday talk shows that they have, but he made a very good point, which is you can't have it both ways if you're Planned Parenthood or on the pro-abortion side, which is you can't say that these aren't humans and then say, but we're selling human parts. You've got to make a choice one way or another. You want to be pro-choice, make a choice one way or another. You're either not going to harvest the organs because they're not human parts, or you're going to acknowledge the fact that these are human beings.
Wow. You know, the question is, will this lead to at least a serious discussion of the defunding of Planned Parenthood? And is it possible, this may not be possible, but can we defund that part of Planned Parenthood that provides the services, abortion services to women?
Well, technically, the funds that are provided by the federal government are not supposed to go towards abortion services, but the problem is that there's a saying, funds are fungible, which means once the money's in the pot and the hand starts going in to use it, well, who's to say
exactly,
you know, what funds are used where, and it's very difficult to properly designate or mark what funds are being used for what purposes.
I really have problems believing that Planned Parenthood is organized well enough internally to say, okay, well, we have these funds and we won't dip into them, but these other ones we will.
Right, and they're very well funded to begin with.
True.
So do they need, and should they receive taxpayer support, federal taxpayer support, for their services? Could they not exist, or would there in the marketplace, would there not rise up and exist the services to provide the reproductive health care services and mammograms and pap smears and all that they provide apart from a Planned Parenthood?
Well, that's the thing. I sense that there's a duplication of services here. I have to think that the 71% of people who are at 150% of the poverty level or below that Planned Parenthood likes to cite as a statistic for people who use their clinics would still be able to find those services elsewhere thanks to Medicaid and other clinics that provide those kind of services that you mentioned. Services that are important to the health care of men and women, but that they could get elsewhere.
Right.
And, you know, no one's arguing that point. We totally agree on that the services should be provided. But you can provide those services without paying for abortion. That's all we're saying.
Absolutely. Well, we'd love to know what's on your mind. And if you attended any of the protests this weekend, good on you. Keep going. I think the tide is turning, and we need to keep the pressure on to have a full discussion and debate on this issue across the nation. Let us know what's on your mind. You can like us on Facebook. You can follow us on Twitter. You can even send your emails to live@lesea.com.
Now on this Monday, August 24th, 2015, here's what's happening in your world. Stocks have tumbled across Asia today, with China's main index losing 8.5% in tumultuous trading. Investors panicked by uncertainty over the economic outlook have unloaded shares in practically every sector. Japan's Nikkei stock index dropped 4.5% by the end of trading. South Korea's Kospi lost 2.5%. The Taiwan stock market closed down nearly 5%. This turmoil goes back 2 weeks to a surprise devaluation of the Chinese yuan, which has shaken investor confidence in Chinese policymakers to mitigate any further downturn. And this recent market downturn has erased all the gains made by the Shanghai Exchange in 2015. Now, Asia's gloom has spread to the European markets, which opened with Germany's DAX falling 2.8% so far. And that seems to be the average across the board from London, Paris, and Berlin. As fears deepen over the slowdown in the world's second largest economy, China's dimming outlook is provoking calls for more economic stimulus from Beijing, though earlier government efforts to staunch the hemorrhage appear to have done little to stabilize the markets. And Wall Street is not immune to the collapse. The Dow dropped 531 points Friday, meaning it has plummeted 10% since a record close in May. And the futures aren't bright today. The Dow's poised for a drop of over 300 points as we approach the opening bell. Four men who took down a heavily armed man on a passenger train speeding through Belgium were awarded France's highest honor today. The four, three Americans and a Briton, were presented with the prestigious Legion of Honor by French President François Hollande in Paris. Hollande said the men prevented carnage on the high-speed Thalys train, which was carrying 500 passengers from Amsterdam to Paris. Spencer Stone, Alex Scarlatos, Anthony Sadler, the three American friends, all around 22 to 23 years old on a European vacation, looked slightly embarrassed as Hollande pinned the ribbon medals on their polo shirts before embracing them and kissing them on each cheek. The attacker has been identified as Ayoub Al-Khazani, a 25-year-old Moroccan national who's reportedly on security watch list in four European countries for his alleged links to radical Islamic groups. Organizers of protests called You Stink that have captivated Beirut postponed demonstrations set for tonight. Last night, the violent clashes with police saw dozens of protesters and police officers wounded. Workers swept away glass and other objects that were set on fire from the streets today. The Lebanese army took up positions in and around downtown Beirut. That's the scene of the protests. And they stationed armored personnel carriers on street corners. Now, the protests have been sparked by a garbage collection crisis that has left trash piled in the streets of Lebanon for weeks. It has grown into a grassroots movement demanding the resignation of the entire government and an end to the country's dysfunctional sectarian system. What started peacefully last week turned violent over the weekend after a small group of young men tried repeatedly to tear down a barbed wire fence separating the crowds from the Lebanese government building. And Europe's stream of migrants from troubled Middle East countries continues. An Irish Navy ship carrying over 200 migrants pulled into the Italian port of Messina on the island of Sicily today. The migrants were rescued over the weekend from the Mediterranean Sea off the Libyan coast. Meanwhile, thousands of migrants from the Middle East crossed over from Macedonia into Serbia on foot, continuing their journey further north toward European Union member states. Many hope to get transit papers that would give them 3 days to legally travel through Serbia in order to reach Hungary. If they manage to enter Hungary, the migrants could then travel freely across the borders of most of Europe. Coming up later, Brian Bush with the latest news from Israel. But up next, award-winning singer Cheri Keaggy joins us to chat about her new album, No Longer My Own. There's more Harvest after this.
With the potential to connect billions of people around the world, LeSEA Broadcasting must receive $100,000 to keep our shortwave radio transmitters up and running with a strong, clear signal. Please help with your gift today. Our shortwave broadcasts reach into hundreds of countries on every major continent. And with more than a billion shortwave receivers in the world, the potential impact of your gift is enormous. Any amount you give will help cover the world so the world can see Jesus. Please give online now at LeSEA.com.
Change the way things are with so many hurts, ominous evil and darkness is lurking. Where is the good in the world anymore, Lord? Tell them I am here, I am watching it all. I have overcome. Lord, I confess I'm afraid, too scared to stand up against the tide. Better to just play it safe though it's getting hard to look away when love looks like justice and mercy. To love without limit, 'cause no one can hurt me. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. Tell them I am here, I am watching it all. You know I have overcome. Tell them I am here, I am lifting you up. The end is near. Don't you know I have overcome?
Jesus said, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Do you have some treasures like silver and gold coins or old jewelry that you don't wear anymore? Why not invest them into changing lives for Jesus? Ask yourself if these treasures are really worth keeping, or should you invest them into making an eternal difference in someone's life? Call 1-800-365-3732 for a prepaid insured shipping envelope. Lay up your treasure in heaven. It'll be waiting for you when you get there.
When's the last time you described your vacation as unforgettable and life-changing? As a Christian, one of the most meaningful journeys you'll ever take is a visit to the Holy Land. Since 1965, the ministry of LeSEA Tours has been privileged to change the lives of thousands of people by providing meaningful and exciting trips to Israel. A visit to the Holy Land with LeSEA Tours is a vacation you will actually experience. You'll walk the same path that Jesus took with the cross, get baptized in the Jordan River, sail on the Sea of Galilee, and step back in time as you visit a first century village in Nazareth, pray at the Western Wall, float in the lowest spot on earth, and get your hands dirty by planting your own tree. But most importantly, you'll experience the land that God chose for His home here on earth, and you'll never be the same. LeSEA Tours travels with you to Israel every February, June, and November since 1965. Call today to receive a free information packet or visit on the web at leseatours.com. In the last 15 years, friends like you have helped send over 700,000 Bibles to anyone who requests a copy through our Spread the Word ministry. God has certainly been working powerfully through your support. The book of Romans says, "How beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news." That's why we're so thankful for your partnership to help us take the best news of all time to more of those who are desperate to hear it. It costs just $5 to send a Bible to someone hungry to read it in Africa, South America, or many other places around the globe. Through your generosity, many thousands have already read about the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And with your support, we look forward to helping fulfill Dr. Lester Sumrall's vision of reaching the untold billions yet untold with the gospel.
Cheri Keaggy began her career as a worship leader at a small church in Southern California before recording her debut album. I'm not going to tell you what the year is because Cheri's right here. Cheri's gone on to record 8 additional albums, resulting in 9 number one songs, 3 Dove Award nominations, a Dove Award win as well, and her newest project, No Longer My Own, has just been released by Psalm 91 Records and Elevate Entertainment. Good to have you with us today, Cheri.
Thank you.
Beautiful, beautiful opening song. Thank you so much for playing Overcome.
Yes.
Let's talk a little bit about, man, you've been on quite a journey. Mm-hmm. And God's used you in a powerful, powerful way. Mm-hmm. You come from a fairly, well-respected and enamored family with in Christian contemporary music mm-hmm. and cutting-edge music. So what was that like kind of growing up? Did you know this is what you were going to do as you kind of, through your teenage years?
What do we know when we're young, you know? But I always played the piano, so mm-hmm. music was a part of my life from an early age. I would say it was when I got involved in the church music ministry at a little church in Southern California that I started writing my first worship songs and just realizing there was a little bit of a writing gifting there mm-hmm. And then was blessed to be able to begin recording and now people singing those songs.
Wonderful.
So I think sometimes God confirms your calling through people, you mm-hmm. know, and the response, and you feel most alive when you're doing that calling, whatever that is, you mm-hmm. know. So
tell us about the title, No Longer My Own. What was the inspiration behind the title to your new project?
I was reading both my kids are married now, and so I'm in the empty nest season. I was reading this book on the empty nest, and in it was included this prayer called the Covenant prayer that most people attribute to John Wesley. Hmm. And I just loved the language in this prayer, just beautiful. I remember writing it down in my journal. And I thought, you know, I want to write a song using a lot of the concepts from the prayer. And so as I sat with all my song titles, Lord, would you have an album title? That was the title that stood out to me, No Longer My Own, because it says so much mm. just in the title itself. So.
Mm. I noticed the last time, your last CD that came out, you talked a lot about healing and restoration. Mm-hmm. What are some of the themes on this one?
Yes, I mean, that album before was just coming out of such a season of brokenness, mm-hmm. A divorce, and both my grandparents dying, all of these griefs and losses, that those were so healing. And this album feels like surrender. It feels like the next chapter. I think when God has humbled you through brokenness, He does a work in you that helps you pull back and look at the world from a broader perspective, because you're no longer so focused on your circumstance that, you know, and you have more compassion towards others. So I feel like this album speaks a little bit more broad to what's going on in the world and the hope that Christ wants to extend to us as believers. Even the song I sang, just, you know, how we're sort of not sure what's happening in our world, and I confess I get a little scared sometimes, but mm-hmm. He says, I am with you, you know. Mm-hmm. No need to fear, I've already overcome. So
I had read, I think it was regards to No Longer My Own, it kind of passed this on to your father, Phil. Was that this album?
Well, you're right, only Phil is my uncle.
Uncle, okay, sorry.
but he's in the family.
Yeah.
Yes.
But your dad was moved so much
yes.
To tears by the words that were contained in here in the music.
Thank you.
Was it why was that? Do you know what really moved him so much? Was it just because it was a kind of sign that, you know, you've been through some things and God's really move powerfully?
Yeah, I think so, because, you know, he knows my story and where I've walked, and of course my parents have been there from the beginning, piano lessons and going to all my recitals and stuff, and so he's heard every album, but as he listened with this one, right, he called me, and I remember I was walking my dog, and he called me, and he just got all choked up, and he just said, Cheri, I just think this is your best one yet, you know, and maybe he was just caught up in the emotion of it, but he said, I know you couldn't have written these things if you hadn't been through the things you've been through, you know, and so, I mean, that's a good feeling, I mean, you know.
But isn't that true? I mean, you have to come from, you know, that place of brokenness and hardship to produce work like this.
Yeah.
So kind of give us the backstory on Sabbath.
Yes, Be My Sabbath is a song that was written out of this season of burnout, like extreme burnout, that I don't get to that place very often because I'm a doer. I'm sort of a type A, I know how to go to God's word to let him refresh me and renew me, but just a lot of pouring out in ministry, opportunities, working, the administration of ministry, the doing of the thing, paying bills, life in general. I got around the holidays to this the end of myself, you know. And I've said many times, when we come to the end of ourselves, we come to the beginning of Jesus, but I was just so empty. And I just remember scribbling out a bunch of words on a page one morning in my robe, you know, my living room couch, you know, and I remember saying, I'm not a machine. You know, I was crying out to God, I'm not a machine. I can't keep going like this. And I remember saying, if faith without works is dead, then I need to die for a day. You know, just, you know, and anyway, and then I realized over time, well, I think there's a song brewing in here, but it was a wake up call for me to know that we're not machines, that he is our source, and that if we're to continue to do the things he's called us to do, which is what I want to be about doing, then we have got to stay anchored to him, and we have got to be immersed in his word, and we've got to observe the Sabbath, both literally and emotionally, and all the ways that he wants to give us rest. So I've grown in that, and I've been speaking a little bit on rest, especially to women, because I think that's something we all struggle with, because we're all wearing a lot of hats, and we can do.
Yeah.
And God is saying, giving us rest as a boundary, as a protection for us. And so now I'm looking at it as, you know what, I get to do rest. And that ties in with the doer in me. You know, I get to do rest. What a pleasure. Doesn't that sound good?
So that's on your to-do list.
Exactly. Rest.
Rest.
Cross it off. Yeah, anyway.
You said also that this is the boldest recording that you've done to date. Why do you say that, and why is that?
Oh, thank you. I think, you know, there's just some strong lyrics. I'm thinking of lyrics. I'm sick of all this wickedness, and I'm thinking of a song that I wrote from Psalm 119 that says, it was good for me to be afflicted that I might learn your decrees. I mean, you know, who says that? But it's in scripture, but, you know, I put it into a lyric. I don't know, I just think that there's some strong statements. If faith without works is dead, then I need to die for a day or a very long weekend, you know. And so I think there's a boldness there with what I'm saying, and it's wrought with scripture. The album is just, I think there's power in that. You know, it's no longer my idea, but it's God's word put to music. You know?
Well, and we see that, though, in scripture, especially with the psalmist, you know,
yes.
That, I mean, expressing frustration, expressing our questions, expressing our moments of, you know, just that, I think it points to the reality of our relationship with the Almighty. We don't have to try to be something we're not.
Yes. Yeah, we can be in a burnout place, or we can be in a joyful place. We can be, he's over it all, you know.
Cheri, how does it feel when you hear people singing your songs? Or even singing back to you when you're,
at a
service?
It's such a blessing. You know, some friends of mine have two tiny little boys, twin boys, and they sent me a video. It was their baby monitor. They were filming their little boy in his crib at night, and he was singing himself to sleep. He was singing one of my songs off this album called Lucky to Be Breathing Your Air. And they sent me just this golden footage of him. He doesn't know anyone's watching it. I mean, that, yes, people sing my songs in churches, on the platform. Yeah. Other people record the songs, all of that. But that just blessed me, filled my eyes with tears, because here's a little boy who is, you know, we remember the songs of our childhood. And so I just felt so good that now this was a part of his vernacular, you know.
It's been planted in his life.
Yes.
One last thing, on this album, now this is your ninth album, and you decided to kind of go with a crowdfunding appeal as well. What led you to go down that road?
Well, it's just God's provision, Jehovah Jireh. I was on a major label back in the day, back in the 90s, and they, fund the records, and of course you pay all that back. But so this is God's means of provision, and so it was very much a step of faith. God had provided through this crowdfunding method for my last album, mm-hmm. and I didn't want to just presume upon Him that He would also provide in this same way for this next album. But so I was seeking the Lord, and I remember I read Seth Godin's book, Tribes. Mm-hmm. And he was talking about how leading any kind of a following requires generosity and bravery. Mm-hmm. And I just had that check in my spirit because I was seeking the Lord about this very thing. And I just knew God would have me to be brave, to step out in faith. And sometimes stepping out in faith is scary. It looks like pressing go even when you're scared, mm-hmm. But you're wanting to do the bold thing and believe God for things bigger than yourself. So, yeah, that was a great thing that He did.
And it's worked out.
It has.
Wonderful.
Praise God.
Thank you for joining us today. And to connect with Cheri Keaggy, you can go to Cheri Keaggy, CheriKeaggy.com. Or as always, you can go to our website, harvest-tv. You'll find an easy way to link back to Cheri's site and pick up a copy of No Longer My Own. Still to come, we're going to hear Cheri perform another song from this new project. But up next, Brian Bush with the latest news from Israel. We'll be right back.
Many Christian ministries have desired to bring the gospel of Jesus to Israel, to proclaim His message of God's love to the villages and streets He walked while on this earth. Yet only one Christian network has been broadcasting the message of God's love to Israel for more than 10 years. By God's grace, LeSEA Broadcasting has been bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ and the voices of many American ministries to every home in Israel via Middle East television. You can help this great work by becoming a partner in faith. For as little as $25 a month, call today.
If you want to do more and be more, but your stamina runs out of steam, you need the top-selling Essential Vitamin Mineral Pack by Dr. Rodrigo Rodriguez. The Doctor's Making Healthy Choices Essential Pack costs only $59.95, but the health benefits are priceless. You get mineral concentrate, an unsurpassed formula of trace minerals essential to good health. Omega-3 for overall vascular support and healthy brain function. Vita Sprouts, a superior form of multivitamins, and you get Solu-C for a strong immune system. That's mineral concentrate, omega-3, Vita Sprouts, and Solu-C, an incredible value for only $59.95. And if you act now, shipping is free. Call 1-800-965-2345 or go to mhclife.com to get the Doctor's Essential Pack from Making Healthy Choices. That's 1-800-965-2345 or mhclife.com. Today, 1.4 million refugees in Iraq desperately need help. Thousands of families have left their homes and cities, leaving loved ones and possessions behind due to the intense violence and persecution brought on by the terror group ISIS. Feed the Hungry is delivering emergency aid and relief supplies to these families. Working alongside Iraqi pastors in Kurdistan, this emergency relief is an encouragement to Christians and Muslims who have nowhere to turn. Your gift of $70 can provide 200 pounds of urgently needed food aid for 5 families for an entire month. Delivered through the hands of local churches, your support lets these families know that they are not forgotten and that they can begin to hope again. Please call 1-877-769-9268 or visit feedthehungry.org.
We talked a little bit about the Middle East in our newscast, but let's get more in depth with Brian Bush, our LeSEA correspondent, who joins us now from Jerusalem. And Brian, big revelation over the weekend there in Israel with the news that Israel was prepared to attack Iran. Tell us about it.
Yes, that's right, Chuck. Not just once, but twice. And the decision was put off. This information comes from tapes made of former Prime Minister Ehud Barak, who was Prime Minister Netanyahu's defense minister at the time. The tapes were made by his biographers, that is to say, Mr. Barak's biographers, but leaked to a major television show here in Israel and broadcast. They broadcast the conversations after Israel's military censor cleared them for publication. Chuck?
So you say Israel was prepared to strike Iran not once, but twice.
That's what Ehud Barak says on the tapes, once in 2009 and again in 2012. In 2009, the IDF chief of staff would not categorically say that Israel had the capacity to carry out a successful strike against Iran. So, two of the eight ministers in Mr. Netanyahu's so-called Forum of Eight got cold feet, according to Mr. Barak. That meant that Mr. Netanyahu didn't have a clear majority in order to carry the plans forward. And so it was scrapped. And in 2012, the weather window permitting a strike to go forward was too close to a joint American military exercise that was already planned for the time. And so they couldn't carry out the strike because it would implicate American involvement because it would come on the heels of this joint military exercise. Chuck?
So that's the backstory. What's the fallout from all of this information, which really from here, Brian, seems to be pretty embarrassing because these are conversations that one would think should be state secrets.
Yeah, well, the people who are in hot water right now are the military censors who allowed the publication to go forward. Secondly, Mr. Netanyahu, he's in hot water because Ehud Barak calls him weak on the tape, and that Mr. Netanyahu prefers fear over hope. Chuck?
So how has Netanyahu responded to the criticism?
Well, Chuck, he's taken the high road so far on all this, saying that let's stop talking about national security issues and that he is leading the country responsibly and aggressively. This isn't the first time that these two men have disagreed publicly. And we have to remember, too, that even though these men are political rivals, they've shared a commonality. They served Israel together in an elite commando unit, and they share a unique bond for the country, and I believe for each other, too, despite the public dissension. Chuck?
All right, good stuff, Brian. Brian Bush reporting from Jerusalem. A reminder that Brian puts together a blog. It's only available on Facebook, so don't forget to go onto Facebook and like the Harvest Show page. Well, we certainly like the fact that Cheri Keaggy has joined us today to perform here in historic Studio B, and she's with us one more time to perform her song, You Go Before.
The answer before the question, you know the ending before it's begun. You set the rain and the clouds in motion, knowing full well you would bring back the sun. Ready and waiting with kind provision, like a lighthouse that shines through the storm. A vision of land for the homesick sailor. You go before. You are the comfort for every heartache. You were the healing before there was hurt, doling out strength for the worn and weary, with storehouses brimming with gifts none could earn. You're the great king, and your kingdom will come with sure victory after the war. Brave on the front line, all these battles, you go before. What do you need? He's already there. Where do you bleed? He's come prepared. Void in your heart would be something you could not ignore. It's high time we lean on that loving Father who goes before.
Through shortwave radio, LeSEA Broadcasting has the potential to reach every one of the 1 billion shortwave receivers around the world. But we must receive $100,000 to keep our transmitting towers up and running with a strong, clear signal. This is the only means we have to continue broadcasting the gospel to hundreds of countries all over the world. Please help with a donation today. Shortwave radio is one of the most effective ways to connect the untold billions yet untold so the world can see Jesus. Our broadcasts have a potential audience of billions of people on every major continent. Every day we receive emails and letters from people who have come to Jesus through our broadcast. Many live in areas where Christians are being persecuted and it's against the law to preach the gospel. But thanks to your generosity, they've discovered the great joy of a new life in Christ. Please send your gift now with untold billions of people yet untold. Give now by calling 1-800-365-3732 or give online at lesea.com.
Fred Felton is a Christian creative artist who is passionate about his work. He's also passionate about shortwave radio, and he joins us now to explain why he supports this vital ministry. Take a listen.
I didn't realize I had talents. You know, the Lord has brought me to a point in my life where I see recovery or repurpose in just the smallest things. Take just the smallest item, rework it, make something out of it, and make it a symbol of God's glory, a piece of worship. This is a piece of a shipwreck that sank in 1860. Brought this piece of timber home. It was a large piece of a frame or a rib. I let it dry out. It sat in my yard. Just looked pretty nice as a piece of wood. And I came to realize that there was something more there. I was in the shed one day, stepped on some of the nails or the spikes that held the ship together, and they had rolled and formed into a cross. And it's like the Holy Spirit slapped me in the back of the head and said, you got something here. So I decided to make worship pieces out of these for the pastors in my life. Well, the pastors received them quite well. Pastor Mitch Olson up in Port Huron at Grace, when I presented his to him and I told him that this piece of timber represented my salvation. The ship, this timber sat in the bottom of the river for 140 years, lost, abandoned, in the cold, in the dark, completely useless. And that's basically the way I spent 50 years of my life. Lost, abandoned, not really serving a real purpose other than myself. And through the grace of God, He raised me up, repurposed me. He's redirecting me, just as I raised up this piece of timber and made it a symbol of His glory. And people really receive these well. People that haven't accepted Christ, haven't surrendered, haven't accepted His love and forgiveness, they just don't know what they're missing. It's just phenomenal. I get up in the morning and, I used to worry about what I had to get done. Now it's a matter of, what do you want me to do? Some days He puts a great list in front of me, and some days I've got to my own. Make these for a general offering, whatever people offer. A lot of people have been very generous, and I in turn just take the money and roll it over and support the shortwave radio. So it's, God's done a whole lot in my life. It's just incredible. LeSEA has helped me to realize that there is no boundaries. There's no limitations to what can be done. You just have to be bold and confident in your faith. You have to examine yourself and really think, are you happy? Are you pleased with your life? Because until you help lead someone to the Lord, you don't understand what joy or happiness is. And LeSEA makes that so easy. It's such an easy partnership for them to reach the corners of the earth.
Dr. Lester Sumrall was given a global vision to reach a million souls every day for Jesus Christ. To fulfill his God-given assignment, he established LeSEA Broadcasting. The ministry today reaches millions of people in more than 190 nations through the power of television, radio, shortwave satellites, free Bibles, and prayer lines. But we need your help. Will you join Partners in Faith by giving a monthly gift of $25, $50, $100 or more? Give today by calling 1-800-365-3732 or visit LeSEA.com.
If you are among the thousands who love the teaching of Lester Sumrall, then you should have the two-volume set of The Treasury of Lester Sumrall. Written in Dr. Sumrall's easy-to-understand style, you'll feel like you are getting a Bible school education. There are 732 individual readings, one for each day for 2 whole years. These beautiful devotionals will also make a wonderful gift for your friends, family, or even your pastor. Order yours today.
Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time He may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on Him, because He cares for you. As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have eternal life.
For 70 years, we've been using shortwave radio to reach many in developing countries with the gospel. We're so thankful for your support, which has helped continue the work Dr. Lester Sumrall began. And through your gifts and prayers, we are excited to continue transmitting God's word by shortwave radio to every major continent in the world, sharing the good news of Jesus with those who simply can't be reached any other way.
LeSEA covers the world through their shortwave program. They blanket the earth. they take the word everywhere, whether people are receptive or not, the word is brought to them. Shortwave radio service is by far the most cost-effective, covers more people, and gives them the opportunity to listen to the Word of God, to decide for themselves if they want a loving God, if they want to be wrapped in His arms. And it's our obligation as Christians to carry the Word of the Lord to everyone. Basically, any amount of a donation, any kind of a tithing, you can impact people's lives across the world. And LeSEA covers the world.
And indeed, shortwave radio frequencies do blanket the earth as they emanate from World Harvest Radio. Here across the LeSEA Broadcasting Network, we've heard from people in 193 nations who have received that signal, and they've taken the time, the effort, some cases the risk, to write back to us to let us know how it's impacting their lives. And this month, we're asking you to help support shortwave radio. We have some repairs that are desperately needing to be done on our transmitter station in Palau, which enters into mainland China, much of Eastern Africa, continent of Africa, and the subcontinent as well of Asia. And without those repairs being done, the signal suffers some. So we want to continue knowing that we're putting our best foot forward with the Ministry of Shortwave, and we're asking you to help us in this month with your support to continue this vital outreach and this ministry aspect of LeSEA Broadcasting. And again, it's a medium that we don't really think about. My neighbor is very much into shortwave radio, from the basis of emergency broadcast services, sure, on a localized level for disasters, which we do here in the United States, all across the United States. So if there's something that goes down, a telecommunications system because of a natural disaster or whatever it may be, shortwave is there to fill in the gap, to keep emergency services connected, to keep the public informed. So that's kind of how it's used here in the United States, and hobbyists use it, obviously, to keep in touch with people all around the world. But around the world, it is still a very vital medium for folks to stay connected. And really, I think I always get these numbers incorrect, so I'm going to do my best here. But at any given time, there's something like a 100 million people listening, wow, to shortwave around, mm-hmm, the world. And those are numbers that come to us from organizations, governmental organizations, like the U.S., the U.K., and others that still use shortwave radio as a means for getting their message out.
Now, I know one of the things that you mentioned is that there are 193 countries, mm-hmm, that have been reached.
That's right.
That we know of. That we have heard from here at LeSEA. Mm-hmm. Now, we used to say 190 countries. So I am curious. I don't know if you know this or not. I'm putting you on the spot. Who are the three new countries that we've heard from?
You know this?
No, I don't.
Okay. We'll have
I
to
wish
find
I
out.
Did.
Yeah, we'll find out. I know it's more than 190. I thought it was 193.
It might be.
Yeah, yeah. But in any case, those are just countries that we've heard from.
That's right.
And then, you know, there are likely others out there that we haven't heard
from. Well, for sure there are, Stephen. And, you know, when you think that there are, what, a billion shortwave receivers in the world, people are, mm-hmm, getting the message out. I, mm-hmm, mean, we wouldn't be able to send you over to North Korea to share the gospel or to, you
know. We could, but I won't be coming back.
That's right. Right. That's, yeah, right. You would probably get arrested, but that's why, you know, shortwave radio is so important. It can go where we cannot go. Mm-hmm. And that's why we need your urgent support. We need to do some repairs on the transmitters there. I've been to the facility in South Carolina, and I've seen the damage. And it's really important. When the transmitter doesn't work, literally, the gospel doesn't go to that particular part of the world. So that's why we're asking you to call now to become a donor. We saw Fred, mm-hmm, Felton talking about, you know, becoming a supporter of shortwave radio. But we need help. We need to continue to share and reach the untold billions yet untold.
I mean, that's nice that they sent you to the one in South Carolina. When you can get the trip to Palau,
I know, right?
Then I'll know that you've reached the big time, Ms. Lowe. But I do want to show you some pictures of the situation over in Palau right now so that you see the magnitude of what we're dealing with. Our shortwave transmitter in Palau sits not very far from the shore of the Pacific Ocean. In fact, you can see a little bit of the Pacific in the background of that shot. And so there's a lot of salt water right there. And as you can tell, that salt water brings a lot of corrosion to the transmitter there in Palau. And when you've got corrosion like that, it keeps that transmitter from being as effective as it can be. Considering how far that signal has to travel from Palau, that transmitter has been very effective in getting the message into Asia, particularly. Stefan mentioned countries like China and North Korea, countries where the gospel is not welcomed by the government, but certainly welcomed by the people there. And we want to be able to continue to reach those people who need to hear the word of God and need to have his hope. But we can't do it without your support. That is why all throughout this month of August, we've been pleading with you and airing special programming to help us with our support of shortwave radio. A reminder, the number is 1-800-365-3732, or you can go online safe and secure at LeSEA.com. Now, you might be wondering today, well, where's Pastor Charles? Where's Pastor Mark? You know, it's Monday. Our pastors are kind of getting a day off, but I do want to share you one word from the treasury of Lester Sumrall, who talks about one of a kind. And he goes, one of the major problems with people trying to find the will of God is that they try to make God do for them what he has done for other people. You know, there are 6,200,000,000 people in the world, and we all have a different fingerprint, and we all have a different will from God. God appreciates our individuality, and each of us can do something special for the kingdom of God. So today, your discernment lesson is to try to figure out what you can do for the will of God and then go do it. And then report back to us tomorrow for another edition of Harvest.
With the potential to connect billions of people so the world can see Jesus, LeSEA Broadcasting must receive $100,000 to keep our shortwave radio transmitters up and running with a strong, clear signal. Please help with your gift today. Our shortwave broadcasts reach into hundreds of countries on every major continent. The potential impact of your gift is enormous. Any amount you give will help cover the world. Please call LeSEA Broadcasting now, 1-800-365-3732.
Harvest Show is produced by LeSEA Broadcasting and is viewer supported by people just like you. Thank you for inviting us into your home today.